hit that subscribe button down below and that bell thingy. Thanks so much.
I found a way to let you in, but I never really had a doubt. Standing in the light of your halo, I got my angel now. It's like I've been awakened, every rule I had you breaking. It's the risk that I'm taking, I ain't never gonna shut you out. Been awakened, every rule I had you breaking, the risk that I'm taking, I'm never gonna shut you
out. Good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. We're going to do some specials for a while. And one that we have done in the past, Where Are the Dead? I think it's neat that we do it again and maybe tune it up and add some more to it. It's one of the most asked questions is, where are my loved ones after they die? And it is made so clear, and the Word of God is so specific on that subject, that I think it's sad that people are not totally familiar with it. Why? Well, for a very good reason. A Christian, one of his most important times to witness is when someone is hurting. If you have the answers whereby you can comfort someone by allowing them to know what kind of father we have and where their loved ones are, then it's a great comfort. And certainly, if we have any compassion at all, we should want to help people, neighbors, friends, loved ones, and so forth. It is a time that you can be of a comfort. And after all, that's what God's children are supposed to be to each other. Where are the dead? Are they out here in a hole in the ground? The answer is no, they're not. Our Father is the God of the living, not the dead. Satan himself has already been sentenced to death, but he's not dead. Spiritually dead, yes. So it is a play on words that many people are confused by not understanding figures of speech. So we're going to start today, and in the next lecture, perhaps we will finish and on the subject, where are the dead? I'm going to start in Luke chapter 23, and we're going to take verse 43. Bear in mind what's happening here. Christ is on the cross. There are malefactors on each side of him. And one of them has said to the other, stop ridiculing him, or something to that effect. He's done nothing amiss. Why would you ridicule this just man? In other words, he was convinced that Christ was the Son of God. What did Christ say to him? He says a great deal in one little verse, verse 43 of Luke 23, and it reads, and Jesus said unto him, verily, this means truly, You can count on it. I say unto thee, today, not tomorrow, not 2,000 years from now, but today shalt thou be with me in paradise. What is the word paradise? It's heaven. It means garden, quite frankly. There are many gardens of God, but what has Jesus said to this one? Today, not tomorrow, not in some hole in the ground, today you're going to be with me in paradise. So Christ, again, he is the Savior of living, not dead. Wouldn't we really have some kind of a Christianity if we could say, oh yes, you're going to live in the ground like a warthog. Well, a warthog doesn't live in the ground. You're going to live in the ground like a mole. You'll be there, and you know, isn't that a victory? Well, it's not a victory. It's terrible. The person, and you must make a note, Christ himself is the Savior of the living, not the dead, all right? Now, what would Christ do when he said today? He would go somewhere. Where would he go? We're going to go to 1 Peter, and we're going to find out what he did while he was even in the tomb. What happened to the people that died before Christ paid the price and before they could have repentance like we do today, except through the sacrifices of the daily oblations and so forth, that prescribed by the law to forgive sin? You couldn't be saved under the law, hardly. You would have to be perfect, and only Christ himself was perfect. So where were those people then? Where were the people that died from the beginning of time? And what did Christ do while he was yet in the tomb? We're going to go to 1 Peter. We're going to pick it up with chapter 3. And I'm going to begin reading with verse 18. Listen to it carefully with the thought in mind, the question, where are the dead? Verse 18 reads, "For Christ also hath once suffered for sins." He was crucified one time in his flesh body. "The just for the unjust." He was the only perfect one. "That he might bring us to God." That he might bring us where? To a hole in the ground? To a ditch somewhere? No. "That he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit." Quickened means to be made alive in the Spirit. What? That transfigured spiritual body. Flesh dies, yes, but man doesn't. Man is a higher creature than flesh alone. Man has a better part to him than flesh. So, verse 19, "by which also," in other words, by which what? "By in this same Spirit also he went and preached unto the saints in prison." Well, where was this prison? It was in paradise. You might say that part of the paradise that was shown in a parable in Luke chapter 16 concerning Lazarus and the rich man, where the rich man could see across the gulf. He could see the throne of God. He could see Abraham. He wasn't in a hole in the ground, but he couldn't cross to them. Why? He was in prison, held for judgment. He didn't make it. But would it be fair, I want to pose a question for a moment, would it be fair that God would judge Noah and everyone that has died since then? I'll back up even to Adam, except that they had the same opportunity that you have today, that Christ's blood would pay for your sins if you repented and believed upon him. The answer, no, that wouldn't be fair at all. It would mean that everyone that died before the crucifixion would be kind of second-class children, because they would not have had the blessedness of having a Savior as we do today. So that's what's happening here. God is allowing Christ Himself, even as He was in the tomb. Sometimes I use the cliche that while He was in the tomb, He was already knocking on Satan's door saying, "Let my people go." So that's who He preached to. Now, you can't be dead consciously, and be able to be taught or preached to. You can be spiritually dead and be preached to, but consciously dead, no. So they weren't at the bottom of the river after the flood. They were not in some hole somewhere dug by man or whatever the case might be. There's a very simple reason. It is said you have a flesh body, but you still have another body. Don't forget it, all right? So He went to those that were in prison that had not overcome, and He preached to them, verse 20, which sometime were disobedient. We all are. We all fall short. When once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls were saved by water. Well, there were eight Adamic souls. The subject matter of the book of Noah, Genesis 6, was the daughters of Adam. Then in that sixth chapter, He was told to take two of every soul aboard the ark. Another subject for another time. But Christ went to those that had died all the way back to the beginning. That's what this figure of speech means. And though they were saved by the blessed ark, they had the opportunity to be saved by Jesus Christ, the only begotten of the living God and the God of the living, not the dead. And they had the opportunity in believing upon Him to repent and cross that gulf back onto the side of victory. I'm drawing from the parable of the rich man and Lazarus in Luke 16. So you see, we have a very fair God. Well, is it written, did any of them accept Him? Well, let's continue on into chapter 4 of this great book of 1 Peter, and let's pick it up at the fourth verse. Let's see if he was successful. Wherein they think it strange that you run not with them to the same excess and of riot, speaking evil of you. Verse 5, who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick, that means the living, and the dead? Well, now you see right there were some of them dead. No, they're spiritually dead. And I'll document that in this lecture. You to give account concerning you. Now listen carefully. 6. For this cause, it was for this reason, was the gospel preached also, underline also in your mind, to them that are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. In other words, they had an opportunity to the same as we do in the flesh today. What were they preaching? The gospel, the good news. Christ died, whereby we may repent, and by believing upon Him, you can have eternal life. And many of them, I have no doubt, many of them believed upon Him and crossed over that gulf, which is simply to say to pass from one side of paradise to the other. And it really upsets some people because to hear you say or to hear it explained, as Christ did in that 16th chapter of Luke, that Satan and his little children are in heaven, but they're in bad shape. They're awaiting judgment. Satan has a few other duties to do, as Revelation 12:7 indicates. But the important thing that you know, God, your Father, your Heavenly Father, is fair. He gave them opportunity, though they had passed from the flesh body even into the spiritual body. They had the opportunity to hear the truth, and they heard it from who? Directly from the mouth of the Savior while he was yet in the tomb before his resurrection, giving them the opportunity, the same opportunity that you have today, even while you dwell in the flesh. Why would he do that? I can go one step deeper into fairness, if you like. If, as it is written, the elect, God's election, were chosen before the foundation of this earth because they stood against Satan, because they were chosen before the katabo, the Greek verb, the overthrow of Satan. Why? They were fighting against Satan. And as it is written in Romans chapter 8, they were justified, meaning they were judged there and foreordained to do the work of God in this age, whereby God could interfere in their lives to bring these scriptures, quite frankly, to pass. God has servants. So, but if God, here's the question, if God chose the election while they were in spiritual bodies, before they were airborne to woman, that is to say, chosen before the foundations of this earth, when they had total recall, wouldn't it be a little unfair then to judge someone to death in the flesh? That's a good question to pose, especially when we see that he gave these that only knew what they had acquired in the flesh because they were born innocent, not knowing, the opportunity in a spiritual body to choose right from wrong. I am sure in my mind that many of them chose the right path because at that time they were in the spiritual bodies. That's why we have the millennium, whereby, again, they will be in spiritual bodies and there will be preachings in the millennium. No second chance. It's just that many people today, they don't have a chance, my friend. Okay, let's go to Corinthians chapter 15. Let's talk about the two bodies. I think it is important that you understand that we do have two bodies. Each person has two bodies, and we're going to talk about that. Paul was asked about it, and Paul, he was an excellent teacher, chosen by God for his ability to teach. Therefore, God through him would bring forth a great deal of the New Testament. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, concerning death, Paul himself was even taken to the third heaven. In the third person, well, he would say, I know not. But he was taken to paradise whereby he could see those that were present there. And now he tries to explain to you and answers the question. Let's just let him do it. Let's pick it up with verse 35, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and it reads, but some man will say, how are the dead raised up? Question. And with what body do they come? I mean, yeah, you know, you don't have to stick around too long, especially as a pastor, until you see people relocated that were buried and so forth, or turned to ashes or dirt, and they're in a hole in the ground. There's not much there to raise up, my friend. But yet people will ask it, and they are taught it. And it's a fair question. But you as a Christian should know the answer, all right, having asked the question. 36, thou fool, or that's a foolish thing, or don't be a foolish one. That which thou sowest is not quickened. I want you to understand that which thou sowest is not made alive. In other words, that you put in the ground is not made alive, except it die. Verse 37, and that which thou sowest, that you put in the ground, thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain or naked grain. It may chance of wheat or of some other grain. In other words, when you plant, let's say, a grain of corn, that grain of corn grew on a cob, and it's a beautiful grain, but it's dead. It has an embryo within it, the same as you have an inner man within you. But when you plant that grain, it isn't that grain that grows from the ground. It dies to feed the embryo the nutrients that it takes to bring it, give it its start. But something far better grows from it. It's a very good analogy. But the flesh must die before the spiritual man can step forth. Now, this is not to say that flesh is not fit or not a good thing, else our Father would not have created man in flesh. But flesh is a testing period to test whether or not you will love God or Satan. So bear in mind, before the flesh and blood cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. You have to be in the spiritual body before you can enter the kingdom of heaven. And let me say, for those that might say, well, if that's the case, let's just jump over the cliff. Well, don't be stupid. Because God sent us here with a purpose and a destiny. Some, God's election, and others, those that would have free will to document that they do love him enough that they will absorb his word and do as they are led. Okay, verse 38, same thought. But God giveth it a body as it hath pleased him, and to every seed his own body. In other words, everyone is different. If you don't think, even in the flesh we're different. We're certainly different in the spiritual bodies. That's how you can be traced by your fingerprints. We are all unique. We are all different. God created us different because it gave him pleasure. He does not like to be lonely. Verse 39. All flesh is not the same flesh. But there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beast, another of fishes, and another of birds. In other words, there are different flesh that God created upon the earth. And yes, the creatures will be in the millennium, for we know that the cow will graze with the bear, that the lamb will lie down with the lion, and the lion will eat the same substance that the other animals do. There will be no carnivores, in other words. Why? Because there's no flesh left in the bodies that they will reside in as well, presumably. In other words, a living lion is not going to eat grass in the body he's in today. Let's put it that way. So what is he saying? If even the animals have different bodies, don't you think you do? Do you think you're not better than an animal? Verse 40. There are also celestial, that is to say heavenly, bodies. You got that? There are heavenly bodies, that's to say of people. And bodies terrestrial, that is to say earthly bodies. But the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. In other words, the flesh does not have the glory that the celestial body has, the heavenly body, your spiritual body. What does your flesh want? Your flesh causes you to do most of the sin that you perform. It's always nagging at you. I'm hungry, I'm thirsty, I want this and I want that, or lust and what have you. It's your flesh body that leads you astray most of the time. When you fail to cause the inner man to rise above the occasion to say, shut up and listen to me, I'm in charge. So you see, there are two bodies. And the flesh body is just a little lower. And the heavenly body is superior. You're more in control. It pleases me that our Father saw fit to allow Christ to offer the same salvation to all those that had died before the crucifixion back to day one of man in a flesh body. Okay, let's go to the next verse. We've got verse 41. There is one glory or splendor of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. For one star differ from another star in glory. God's children are called the stars, his heavenly stars. Why? Well, I suppose if we were to have known the order of things in the first earth age, we could understand that. They are called stars in the book of Job, where he says the sons of God being those stars that laughed and played and were the children of God. It is mentioned again in the book of Revelation in chapter 12, where it stipulates that Satan drew a third of the stars with his tail. It's God's children. We're all different. That's what he's telling you here. God had a purpose for creating each one of us in the way that he did. Why? It pleased him. Verse 42. So also is the resurrection of the dead. Listen carefully. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. That means in the Greek that it is sown in a body that perishes. It is raised in incorruption. In other words, the spiritual body is not something that will waste away. It is not perishable, right? The subject is the body, okay? You got two. You got a flesh body that's going to deteriorate, but you've got a spiritual body that's not perishable. Flame wouldn't hurt it. Ice wouldn't hurt it. Age wouldn't hurt it. Verse 43. It is sown in dishonor. In other words, flesh is always dishonor. That is to say, we all fall short. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, and man is weak in the flesh. It is raised in power. Power of God. This body is weak. It is susceptible to any disease that comes along, most often if it is not immunized to various things, and that is natural by following God's laws. It's sickly, it's puny, it's weak compared to the power of our Father. Just the way it is. What we have to look forward to. Verse 44. It is sown a natural body. That means flesh. That means as you see yourself. It is raised. This is how it is raised. The flesh is not coming out of the ground, okay? It is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body. You do have a flesh body, and there is a spiritual body. You do have a spiritual body. There are two different bodies. The natural stays behind. Why? Why would you want it? It's sickly, it's weak, it's organic in as much as it was made from the soil, and the food that sustains this body is the organic minerals, vitamins, and so forth that we derive from eating organic material and or organic material that has been eaten by another animal and then eating the flesh of that animal. There are two bodies. You got it? 45. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, that's Ha-Adam, was made a living soul. Understand, he was made, created, formed, a living soul. The last Adam, that is to say Christ, was made a quickening spirit. In other words, through Adam came sin into the world, via Satan, whereas by Christ He had a quickening effect. That means to make alive in the Greek. Check it out in the Greek yourself in your Strong so that you have this down right. A quickening spirit is a life-giving spirit, not death-giving spirit, a life-giving spirit. 46. Howbeit, that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. Why couldn't it be, he's asking, that God could not have made us spiritual first, where you could see it? Well, in a sense, if you're familiar with the first earth age, he did. Why were we made natural then? Because of Satan's rebellion and the rebellion of the children that rebelled with him. It is written in Genesis chapter 6, verse 3, I believe 3 or 4, 3, that it grieved God that he had made man flesh also. Meaning, only in the first earth age, only the mammoths, dinosaurs, that sort of thing, were flesh. Man was not. He was in the spiritual body. But it was to prove and to document, born innocent, whether they would love God or Satan. Who are you going to follow? All right, verse 47. The first man, this word is Adam, is of the earth, earthly. The second man is the Lord from heaven, Emmanuel, God with us. The first man was formed. The second Adam, Christ, the life-giving one, the anointed one, was from heaven inasmuch as he was the only begotten of God himself. 48. As is the earthly, such are they also that are earthly. If you're in the flesh, you're going to be earthy, all right? And as in the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. Kind of, I could write so much into that, not really write it into it, but pull it from it because it is there. It's according to which of your men that you listen to. Your flesh, there's no gender in that. It applies to all. It's according to which you listen to, the earthly or the heavenly. You consist of both. Which do you listen to? Which one wins? Verse 49. And as we have borne the image of the earthly, just as sure as you've lived in the flesh, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. As you were made, as God would say, let us make man in our image. He was speaking to the Elohim, that is to say, God and the angels. And each soul from that day was placed into that embryo and would part the cervix and be born earthly, innocent. And then Christ would come, giving us salvation, whereby we could see and have life rather than death. Because of the sins that had committed, each committed his image. If you have seen the Son, you have seen the Father, because Christ was begotten in the exact image of Almighty God. And quite frankly, you were begat in the same image. And why you became a living soul when you entered the earth is because you looked just like you did there. Let us make man in our image, plural. Verse 15. Now this I say, or you can count on this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. If that's all you got going for you, friend, you're in a lot of trouble. There is no way you're going to inherit an eternal seat if you're all in the earth. Neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. In other words, there is no way that corruption can inherit a perfect body. Won't do it. Flesh is sin, carnal. The inner man is the better part of you. 51, listen carefully. Behold, I show you a mystery. Now, do you want to understand the mystery? We shall not all sleep. We're not all going to die. But we shall all. Now, does that say some of us? Well, just the people of this denomination. No, those of that denomination, those that go to that. No, all. A-L-L, all. Be changed. We're all going to be changed into a spiritual body. Why? We've all got one. We all have a spiritual body. We all have a flesh body. How has that happened? 52. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. What is the last trump? There's seven of them. You figure it out for yourself. The Greek is very specific. The farthest one out, the seventh trump, when Christ returns. For the trumpet shall sound, not maybe, when it's time, it'll honk. And the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. The spiritual, now listen to me, hang on to this. Those that are spiritually dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. They're going to go into that spiritual body. But there's a little more to it. Listen to this. Many would say, well, I cannot handle that. The judgment hasn't been yet, and they're raised in an incorruptible body. You got it, because it's one or the other, friend. You can't go before God in the flesh unless He so decrees specially. Flesh and blood cannot enter His presence. So you got to be changed to even go there to be judged. Have you got it? Here will be your answer, verse 53. For this corruptible must put on incorruption. That's to say, this corruptible body, this body that is flesh, it ages, it withers, must put on incorruption. And this mortal, what do we got here? Mortal, this mortal, you're talking about your soul now, not your body. This mortal soul must put on immortality. Now, I could trust you to check these out for yourself. The last time I taught this subject, I did. I'm not going to do it today. It isn't that I don't trust you, but it's that not everyone has the ability to have access to a Greek dictionary. So I'm going to do it for you. I want to take the word corruptible. Let's get what it, in other words, that's where your documentation is. Let's pull up the Greek word 5349, and you see that it is thartos. It is from another word. It means decayed. Implication, perishable. It's your flesh. That's when, and translated in the King James as corruptible. That's why the flesh is perishable. It will decay. And if you unfortunately, and I hope you never have to, but if you've ever been in war or in other places, you find out how quickly a body can decay. All right? Now, speaking of the body, first, to identify that corruptible has to do with the body, your spirit or your soul can never decay. Not actually. If we were to use it as an analogy, maybe so, speaking in a spiritual sense. But in the natural sense, no way, friend. This body decays, all right? Let's see what it is that it puts on. The word incorruption, it is your Greek word 816. It is atharsia, and it means, in the genitive sense, unending existence, deathlessness, in other words. In other words, it's not perishable. It is eternal, immortal, meaning there is no beginning and there is no end to it. It is a body that will last you forever. So what have we learned? This corruptible, perishable, sickly, a body that ages with time will put on the spiritual body. Remember what Paul says? I don't want you to be ignorant of the fact that you have two bodies. Will step out at the moment the flesh dies into that incorruptible, a body without end, unless God so decides to end it. But what's this word mortal? I want you to know what it means as well, mortal. And it is the Greek word 2349. And it is thanatos. It means liable to die. That's all it is. Your soul is liable to die. Why? God's going to sentence it to death at the great white throne judgment. Anytime you're still mortal, it simply means you're liable to die. It's talking about your soul. Now, what is immortality? It's a word, even though it is Greek, that many of you are used to. It's the Greek 110, athanasia. It's from a compound as the negative particle, and it means deathlessness. There's no death involved. Deathlessness. Eternal. So, what did we find out? This flesh, putrid, corruptible body must put on a body that has deathlessness to it. That is to say, a body that will last forever. It won't wear out. The knee joints won't get old. The hip bones won't have to, or joints won't have to be replaced. The femur and the neck of the femur will never wear out. Quite frankly, because there would be no weight on it in the first place. But we are made in that image, and don't worry, it'll have a femur, and there will be a neck to the femur. The body parts will be the same, made in a different, I want to be careful there. We don't want to get into the gender sense, but you understand. Then, yes, everyone will be raised in a spiritual body, but those that are spiritually dead here, and I probably should use a different terminology, but you're sharp enough to follow me. Those that are not in good standing with God still have a mortal soul, meaning a liable to die soul. Why? If they don't overcome, they're going to die. So the mortal soul must put on immortality, athanasia, which is to say deathlessness. There you have it. You have the conditions of both the flesh and the spiritual body, and you have the soul that is corrupted, and you have the soul that has athanasia, which is to say deathlessness. Okay, I want to go two more verses and we'll conclude. 54 in the same chapter. So, when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal, understand two different things, your body and your soul, when this body has put on incorruption, and this soul that is mortal, liable to die, shall have put on athanasia, which is to say deathlessness, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. We have that victory in him. One more verse, 55. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? It has no victory because we overcome in Christ. It is so important that you understand you have two bodies, or you're never going to understand where the dead are. And it is, secondly, you give yourself a second-class God if he is a God of the dead instead of the living anyway, a God that can't give us a good quality of life eternal. It's not all powerful. He is all powerful. And the instant this flesh dies, stepping from it is that spiritual man, and he returns to the Father who gave it. In the next lecture, We will document this beyond anyone's shadow of a doubt.